like in normal bank, they can transfer money with their and get money to their own accounts, not through the commercial bank. It was always difficult to explain in the beginning, in the 2002, that a credit union is also a credit institution. And even we changed the way the local or governmental authorities spoke about the different laws. It was written that this and this applies to banks, this and this applies to banks. And we said, hello, there are credit unions which are credit institutions. So practically, you won't see a law now in Lithuania which is written banks, except the law on banks. In any other laws concerning financial institutions, it's written credit institutions. That means us and banks. Yes, other services and supervision and monitoring. For other services, so we provide IT, legal advisors, management advisories, trainings, etc., but not as developed as the colleague from Poland. We don't have special enterprises for that to manage. It's in our structure on department level. So now from the supervision side. So we have a state supervision. The Bank of Lithuania, from the very beginning, is regulating credit unions. And we pay a fee, and credit unions pay a fee for supervision. It is 0.017% from the assets. Also, we have deposit insurance fund, which is every depositor is insured up to 100,000 euros. We pay 0.2%, and now it's increasing, and it will increase up to 0.35. So it's more than banks pay in Latvia. Yes, also we have direct access to Bank of Lithuania Clearinghouse and the other banks and other foreign banks. So this is basically our structure. As for the equity membership, there I will give you some slides. You see, this computer is not genuine Windows, so it wasn't me. Yeah. So as for the equity, as you can see, the growth of shares, reserves, it's growing. Everything, it's okay. But we have faced huge losses when the banks not us, you know him, you know it, the name, you faced it too, sorry for that. But our credit unions hold large amounts of their current accounts in this bank, and they lost money there. So that's why we have some losses which we have to recover. As for the shares, we have one permanent share, which is 28 euros, and we have additional shares, which you have to buy if you want to borrow money. So that means if you want to, let's say, with one share, you could buy, you can have a loan of 280 euros. If you want 2,800 euros, so you have to put additional share into the capital, and when you paying back the loan, so the share capital is being returned to you back. But now it's not obliged in the laws. As for the membership, what was good that even during those hard times when the losses and the bankruptcies were facing Lithuanian credit unions, and a lot of we heard a lot of rumors about the collapse of Lithuanian credit union system here, that the talks were in Latvia, and they were very, calls from our colleagues from Latvia. They said, well, tell the truth, is it's already closed or you will survive, etc., etc. So it had huge impact here. But as for the membership, you see, we practically hadn't had any drop in membership. That means that we were still trustworthy or considered as a trustworthy organization. And as for the deposits and loans, we had some slight decrease in 2008, now then we recovered slowly, time by time, but for deposits, it's always been a growth. You can see a small drop here, and yes, we say that the success is a bad teacher. The quote is not by me, by Mr. Bill Gates. And it's true. You cannot learn from the success when you speak, how you are doing well, etc., etc. It's one thing. But when you face real problems and when you find solutions, that are the lessons that you will keep in your mind. So it was the closing of the largest credit union in Lithuania. So Polish, we were in front of you. You closed the second largest, we closed the largest credit union. And in terms of success, it's a battle. Yeah, it was competition. In overall, there were closed five credit unions, but actually it was three credit unions, and all of them were, as a colleague from Poland, Mr. Pavel, told that it was organized crime. When you issue a loan, you took a collateral, and you evaluate it with 20 times the value, and you go on and on and on, and all of a sudden, the regulator comes and sees that there is a huge hole and you do nothing, just declare the bankruptcy. And by the way, the largest credit union was our member. And you may ask, stabilization fund, what is it needed for? So the stabilization fund was used 19 times. But it was used by small portions just to help credit union with capital, help them with solvency. But that credit union was about 20% of the share of the market share of credit unions. So it was not too big to fail. It failed. Yes, and all depositors were paid by state insurance fund. But then the interesting things started to happen. Both from the regulator, both from us as an organization with self-regulation. It was, yes, and the growth of assets, now we have around 450 million euros in assets. So, when all these things happened, we started to ask ourselves, could we avoid risks? And we unanimously voted no, we cannot. But can we manage risks? And we unanimously voted yes. So we have here listed some kinds of risks that our credit unions are facing. So as for each or the majority of them, I will put some tools that we've implemented as a system or a regulator implemented as a, let's say, entity responsible for depositors' money. So, as for credit risks, our loan to assets proportion is around 75-80%. So that means we are practically in loans. But those credit unions who are not with the system, they have different proportion. They are basically investing to the government bonds. So we had to deal with credit risks, as all the losses came from that part. So what did the regulator do? They imposed different capital adequacy ratios. Before that, the capital adequacy ratio for credit union was 1, and it was 13%. Comparison to banks, it was 8%. There they introduced the gradual system that credit unions with the loan portfolio concentration in businesses, they had to hold a larger capital solvency, capital adequacy ratio, which was 13 like a normal one, then it was 18, and then it was 25. So that means if you finance, or your loan portfolio consists of 60 and more percent to businesses, that means you have to keep higher capital to cover the risks. It was tough, especially for those with high concentration. And to tell the truth, it was only 1 year given to find the sources of capital. That means we had to rush very quickly. So to say, we were fortunate that only 3 credit unions from our system faced that burden to hold the maximum risk. And we helped them with a stabilization fund with subordinated loans. So that means we gave credit to capital, let's say. Of course, it's an unsecured loan, but we managed as a system. So that means, you know, to have an integrated system, it's already a benefit for those who are within the system. Also, we as a credit union, as a central credit union, a self-regulating body, we've implemented, how do you say, a secondary loan evaluation model. That means if a loan is larger than 86,000 euros, it has to go through the risk officer sitting in the central credit union, which has no involvement with the loan. That means he's kind of independent eyes, and he asks very, you know, difficult questions, but that way we are managing risks, credit risks. Liquidity risks. We have never faced liquidity risk up till now. And let's say for central credit union, because we are holding all the money, so liquidity ratio is 150%. As for the overall liquidity ratio for the old movement, it's about 55%. So that means if the requirement is 30%, so it means that we are very well over liquid. But it's not very there's no reason for holidays for that, because that means we are not putting money into business. Operational risks, people, IT processes. These were the least one that we took and considered into account, and we saw a lot of problems there, because who gives, let's say, loans, who accept deposits? It's not the systems. You can build the system whatever you want, but the people are doing this. So that means we have to consider the processes, put it into IT, and put training to people. As for the operational risks about the volunteers, it was a huge, huge discussion with the regulator. Because they say, well, it was a question, what do volunteers do? They are paid nothing, and they are held to be responsible for the money matters. So what is this? And in the general meeting, let's say, surely there were situations when you need to elect a member of the board or to re-elect the board. So who wants? I don't want. Okay, come on. You just, for 5 years, you will sit there and do nothing, basically, just to be, you know, just to sign and that's it. And that we had to change because the regulation was getting tougher and tougher. And what did the Bank of Lithuania do? They imposed examination of the members of the board, and both the supervisory council and the loan committee chair. So that means if a person has no qualification, which is, let's say, experience in credit institution, working at credit institution for 5 years at least, you know, don't have higher education, though that means, but if you are smart, you are very self-educated, you have to go through an exam. It was huge resistance, but right now, no one even asks a question about that. Everyone understands that if you want to run a financial institution, you have to be responsible, you have to have knowledge, and sometimes you have to read documents, rules, etc. Not to know that they are put somewhere and they are written for somebody. No, they are written for your organization, for yourself. Yes. Reputational risk. So that means examination and our internal training. So we basically are developing our own system, how to train the elected offices. Reputational risks. We started to measure our reputation because, no, banking business goes with reputation very closely. And during this crisis, before that, we had, trustworthy ratio about 16% of the population of Lithuania trusted credit unions. We were happy about that, considering the discount allowance about this fluctuation. So it's plus minus 5%. After the bankruptcy of five credit unions, we had measured our trustworthiness. It was 3%. Three. So basically, that means with 5% allowance about these error levels, it was negative. But we worked well. You can manage what you measure. Yes. So we measured constantly the ratio of the trustworthiness among the population. I can say that after 2 years, now we have gained 16% again. So that's good for us. Compliance risks. Okay. So. Yes, there are different rules, regulations, documents, etc. you have to follow and you have to keep up to date. So in Central Credit Union, we have a compliance officer which manages compliance for all credit unions. So that means centrally we established a person who follows all the decisions are followed by the rules, by the laws, etc. Business risk. Well, it's kind of a different thing. But to tell the truth, as a banking institution, as a credit institution, we didn't have our own risk department up till 2012. That means that for 10 years, we were thinking that we are managing risks, you know, ourselves somehow, we are self-conscious, etc., etc. But when we established the risk management department, all of a sudden there were a lot of questions arising. It's about, let's say, about milk. Do we finance milk? Farmers who produce milk. Of course we finance, but what are the risks? Because, you know, this situation with Russia borders closing, etc., and then the overflow of milk and prices decreasing, etc., etc. So that department basically started to cover the business risk, and we put advices to our credit unions where to put people's money, to whom to lend, to whom to not, and where to consider some risk factors. And market risks. It's basically interest rates and bond prices. What we do, we constantly issue up-to-date information about the interest rates for credit unions. And to tell the truth,